Pushkar Mishra.
Yeah, just one more talk before we become creators of abusive language due to hunger. But if you're wondering why this talk is here and not in social media track, I don't know either. But but glad you found me. I really appreciate it. Thanks for coming. So my name is Pushkar. I'm a researcher at Facebook AI. And today I'm presenting this work that my colleagues and I did in the domain of abuse detection. I've broken this talk into four different parts. First, I'll go over the motivation behind this line of research that I'm going to present. I will recap some past work that we've done before on author profiling for abuse detection. I'll discuss the shortcomings of the past work, and then I'll basically get to the paper that we wrote for this conference, how we address those shortcomings. Okay, so Wasim and Hovi, in their previous work in NACL 2016, showed that incorporating user features or traits of users like their gender and location actually leads to better modeling of abuse in the content they generate. But the problem with taking such traits into account is that these traits do not actually leverage the homophily that exists amongst users. Basically, the idea that users associate themselves with those that appear similar, and they form virtual circles around opinions. They often subscribe to certain ideologies. That's where author profiling comes in. So author is any user whose data is of concern to us. So for example, those who have composed samples in a data set. And author profiling then is the concept whereby an author's traits and characteristics are inferred and modeled based on the different social media activities they do, the topics they subscribe to, the people they follow, etc. Now, what connects these two concepts, author profiling and abuse? Well, let's take an example. In 2012, Matthew Zook showed in his report that racist tweets against President Obama's re-election were actually not uniformly distributed across the US, but they were instead clustered. So this suggests that there exists some sense of community and homophily amongst abusive authors. And that is the line of work we followed in our previous research, whereby we worked with the same data set as Wasim and Hovi, which contains about 16,000 tweets, and which have been written by around 1,900 unique authors. We created a graph of these authors where we instantiate an edge between two if one follows the other. And we apply Node2Vec to this graph to generate embeddings for users, which basically captures their neighborhood information as well as some idea of their structural role in their respective communities. When we actually appended these author profiles, as we call them, onto baselines, very strong baselines, like character engram logistic regression baseline, we actually saw great gains in performance, both in precision and recall, across both classes, racism and sexism. We figured that these gains are actually coming from the fact that author profiles are able to better capture contextual information and hence help with implicit abuse that is very hard to catch. But there's an obvious shortcoming that we noted, which was hurting both precision and recall, is the fact that there can be misclassification if you're a clean author surrounded by abusive authors or vice versa. So we were actually misclassifying some tweets which are benign, and we were also misclassifying some other tweets that are not benign. So what are we really missing there? The fact that Node2Vec was producing author profiles for us which only takes structural and community information into account. We are not taking a lot of information like the individual traits of the authors and the nature of the tweets that they've already tweeted. So in a sense, we are producing author profiles that are not actually specific to the task. So in this paper, in addition to modeling the social network, we actually model the linguistic behavior of the authors and their communities as well. To do so, we developed novel methods for generating author profiles based on graph convolutional networks. And we show that we actually outperformed our previous state-of-the-art approach that I just discussed. So for modeling this linguistic aspect, we actually extend the previous graph. So in previous graph, we had author nodes and we had connections between authors. We actually extend that graph and we put nodes for tweets in the training set. And then on this particular extended graph, we actually apply our apply graph convolutional networks. So graph convolutional networks are actually neural architectures for learning on graphs, which are basically just stacks of graph convolutional layers. The input to this architecture is the adjacency matrix of the graph and a matrix containing initial feature vectors for each of the nodes. The output from this architecture can be anything ranging from softmax distributions to embeddings to whatever you may like, depending on the last layer. How they work, basically each layer is performing a standard neural network propagation as defined by the recursive equations there. And in essence, what it's really doing is that it's performing a Laplacian smoothing of features that we had initially on the nodes over the node's neighborhood. So it's distributing those features over the neighborhood. The GCN we worked with in our paper is actually a two-layer GCN, because we wanted to model the individual traits of the authors and also the linguistic traits of their community. And as initial feature vectors, we just use binary bag of words because we want to remain as simple as possible when we're capturing linguistic traits. And the output from our GCN was a softmax distribution for every node over the three classes in the data set, that is the racist, sexist, and clean. This GCN trains via gradient descent and backpropagation. The objective was to minimize the cross entropy loss on the tweet nodes because only those have labels. We don't have any labels for the author nodes. Once trained, the outputs from the first convolutional layer constitutes the node embeddings that we used. And for author profiles, we just use the embeddings that we get for the author node specifically. When we incorporated this in instead of the node to vec embeddings, we actually see significant improvements across all metrics on both the classes, racism and sexism. And actually, the nice thing is that not only do we get better gains in understanding the content, but also the fact that the GCN is able to provide softmax distributions for the author nodes. And if we actually project the embeddings, the profiles into low dimensional space, we see that the abusive authors, that is the sexist authors that have that the GCN deems to be racist and sexist according to the softmax distribution, they are clustered in a small space in the visualization. So in summary, traits of users and lexical semantic features are often good, but they're not enough to capture contextual information that is very important for implicit abuse. Taking community-based information of authors into account greatly enhances performance, as we did in our previous work. But also, frameworks for graph learning can actually boost performance further by incorporating linguistic behavior of authors in the graph. All the code for this work is public. And yeah, that is all. Thank you.
We have time for questions. Please use the mic, introduce yourself.
Hello, Bora Edizal. In the results, you show that distribution of users. Did you check, also did you try to discriminate between racist and sexist ones, and do they constitute a separation or something like this?
Yes, that's a nice question. Actually, the problem with this data set in doing that is that authors that have contributed racist tweets have also contributed some of the sexist tweets. So, and the authors that have contributed racist tweets are very few in number. So that does not provide a very good partition. But it would be interesting to see where we have enough variety or like numbers in both varieties.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I had a quick question. Are you showing? Maybe I'll use the mic.
Are you showing? Are you able to show when a system is making a prediction? Are you able to show how much of the prediction is because of the community and how much because of everything else? Because it seems like this is the sort of thing. It was good to have that idea, especially when it can go wrong and you're blaming this person only because of the community. It's good to have those percentages out.
Yes, that's actually a great question. Also touching upon the fact that is this ethical to do where we are profiling authors? So here in this work, we are also stressing the fact that we are not using traits of the author itself. So we're not using the gender, we're not using anything associated with the identity. We are solely modeling on the basis of what people have done. Whether it's possible to separate the two aspects, linguistic behavior and can we interpret them separately? I believe we can. We can actually, maybe we can have multiple runs where we exclude and we do that ablation. But yeah, it is something that maybe should be incorporated when you're building this system, to make sure you're not just blindly actioning against users just based on their community. Yes, I would say.
Hi. So I have a question on what kind of graph you used. It seems like, I think on one of the slides, the graphical network is based on undirected graphs. Have you investigated like directed graphs and kind of like what's the rationale? For example, in my mind, the fact that I may be following abusive users might be a slightly different thing than if the abusive users are following me.
Yeah, that's actually a great point. And yes, in this work, we didn't actually go to that extent. But also the fact that the GCN we use, the graph neural network we use, is the most basic one, the most vanilla version of it. We should definitely look into actually modeling not only directed edges, but also different relations. For example, even if you're interacting, you may actually be debunking what the other author is saying. So you don't become abusive just because you happen to be commenting on something that's abusive. So those different aspects can be modeled better by more powerful graph neural networks that exist today. But yes, in this work, we only work with undirected edges.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, that concludes our session. Let's thank all the speakers.